This is Bianna Marie, and you're listening to Hoobazoo.com.
Can you dig it? Can you dig it? Can you dig it?
This is blasphemy. This is madness. This is the booth.
Staring down, looking at the blood-stained concrete. You're the dead MC, flying at my feet. You took a 9mm rhyme straight to your mind. Damn, I better split. This is my time, so I make my way up the block. Get to home base and lock that up. Crack the Cavassier and grab the phone. Call one of my troops up. Hope the soldier's homie says, yo, what's up, what's going on? Make it quick, cause I'm trying to get my stellar on. Go. Your girl, I'm in the... These lyrical assassins tried to pull a hit, and then boom, came a noise from the other room. It was the boys in blue with the SWAT crew. They got us locked up for lyrical murder. It's one of them charges that you never heard of. It's the booth, the booth, the booth, the booth. Yeah, it's the booth, the booth, the booth. Yeah, we're killing all your podcasts like the HIV virus. You want to battle this kid? Huh, don't even try this. Back the up, think again, count to 10. You want to grab that mic just to get done in? It's the booth, the booth, the booth, the booth. Yeah, it's the booth, the booth, the booth, the booth. Yeah, it's the booth.
Was he African?
African.
No. He was American, and he was like you. He looked just like you.
He was Jewish.
Just Wait, like
okay.
him.
Okay, Jew. It's an odd crime for a Jew to commit.
Yeah, pretty docile.
Okay, so we have an African Jew wearing a hoodie.
No, you don't. No, that's not what I said. Is that what you heard me say? I said he looked like you. Do you look like an African Jew?
No, I look like a cop.
Yeah.
He was Caucasian.
All right, your boy, Citizen One, broadcasting live from the City of Champions. You are listening to The Booth. It is February 17th. We are holding it down tonight in the city of Brockton. I've got my guest. Well, actually, it's my co-host on with me tonight. I'm going to let him introduce himself. Yeah. And before we get into this show tonight, I got to thank everybody for tuning in. I'm actually going to be giving away a Vianna Marie shirt tonight. So y'all want to make sure you hold it down and check in and watch for this, because it's going to be fire tonight. And I got to give big thanks to my special guest from last week, Erik Young from Audios. Erik Young is the young man who came on here. He is the inventor, the CEO, and founder of Audios wireless speakers. These were speakers that are not wireless on Wi-Fi. They don't run wireless on Bluetooth. They are wireless independently. You can hook up to 16 speakers on your own. This gentleman came on with his product. It's only $100 to invest right now at the bottom level. April 30th, that's it. It goes off to the big investors. If you don't get in and this blows up, you're going to be kicking yourself in the ass later on. So it's just $100 to get in there. I got to thank everybody who's been locking it down and jumping on this for that $100, because to be honest, a young black man to be the CEO, the founder, and the inventor of a product is huge. He's got 7 patents on this product. 3 of them are already signed. For us in the black community, we're always talking about making sure that we support black-owned businesses and black-owned this and black-owned that. This is a black-owned product, a black-invented product, a black-founded product that is being offered to people at the bottom level for only $100. And like I said, man, there's no excuse for me to jump on it. I just bought 4 Xboxes for me and my boys. I said, you know, this is the thing that we do here in our community. And, it, you know, it's always a conversation that I like to have when and people say, well, why are you calling people out? Well, it's not calling people out. It's just being honest. If you can go and buy Reeboks or Nikes or whatever at 200 a piece, invest in your future for the $100. Trust and believe me. Vianna Marie jumped on board. I heard Pretty Poison was going to jump on board. My cousin Rebel Rom is looking to jump on. My man here in the corner here, I'm going to be introducing him. He's nodding his head. He knows what I'm talking about. But I got to thank him for coming on. Also, the second hour last week was Penny Lane. That was her fake name that we had to make up to protect her, but she was a Marilyn Manson survivor. That second hour was a crazy, crazy hour for her on our show tonight. I have to thank everybody for tuning in. But tonight, I've got a special guest joining me tonight on the left side. You see my man over here, Kevin Jefferies, goes by the name of Carlito. And I'm just going to break it down on how we met. I'm part of this group called Podcast Nation. And Podcast Nation is a group of all these different podcasters because podcasting is big now. I've been doing podcasting since 2003, like before anybody knew what podcasting was. Nobody even cared what it was when I was doing it. People was laughing and joking at me. I was showing up at Bellator with all my stuff to do interviews. I interviewed Bjorn Rebney with my stuff, and they was all like, who is this guy? Media people with the cameras were like, what is this guy got? What's he doing? And now podcasting is this big, crazy deal. And I've been doing it for a long time, so I've been giving people a lot of advice. So while I was out there, I saw this show, Happy Hour with Lito. And this dude was pulling a lot of good guests, like solid guests, comedians, like I'm talking big guests. But he had no video, he just had audio. And I hit him up and I was like, hey man, what's going on with your show? He's like, yeah, you know, I'm not comfortable with video right now and this and that. And I'm like, look, bro, I'm gonna help you out, and I'll tell you right now that you can have video and have your show out there within a week if I help you and walk you through this. And I know he was probably like, who's this dude? This dude's crazy. And sure enough, how long was it before we had video and you had Houston Alexander on your show? You've had Gary Maselli on your show. It's been crazy, right?
Yeah, it's been nuts. It probably was maybe a week, if that. it wasn't long at all.
Yeah, and you know, I talked him through it. He listened, and like I said, I'm straightforward with people. I don't pull no punches because I want them to succeed. And Carlito here, his show right now, look, nailed down Houston Alexander. And this goes with guys like Matt Cameron. Matt Cameron's Maddie C Sports for You and Me. He's holding it down. He's got his fifth NHL player coming on his show right now, Maddie Cameron. So big ups to him. Travis Partington, he's over 250 episodes into his podcast after I first met him. So let them know, Carlito. Talk about your podcast right now before we get into my show tonight. But let them know how they can see you, how they can follow you. And give them a little history about yourself, too. Because you just told me you're going to be sending me some music because you do tracks.
Yeah, well, I've been making music for years. Probably started when I was about 17, 18, somewhere around there. I'm in my 30s now. And music is like my therapy. So, you know what I mean? I love music. But as far as podcasting goes, I started this maybe, I would say, initially it was going to be me and another person. Mm-hmm. We were going to go ahead and make a podcast or whatever. Because everyone always said they wanted to do one. But then they would say, like, well, they don't know how. So I went and I started researching, you know what I mean, different places, different platforms and stuff like that to get on. I ended up finding Anchor, you know what I mean, to start off. And Anchor wasn't bad, you know what I mean, just, you know, to start off and everything, get your listens up and get some listeners and things like that so people will be checking for you on other platforms. Now my the co-host that was supposed to be doing it with me, he kind of backed out. So I was like, you know what, I'm just going to do this by myself. So I started Happy Hour with Lito podcast. Lito is my rap name. Everybody knows me by that. And really, I mean, it took off. I started to, you know, reach out to, you know, comedians, actors, you know, rappers, MMA fighters, because I love UFC, Bellator and stuff like that. So I started reaching out and, you know, slowly but surely, and also battle rappers, slowly but surely people started.
Yeah. Big L, you had Big L on your show. And I watched it, and that was
Big T,
and that was a good show. And I've done some battle raps myself, but you're handling big time battle rappers.
Big T, that's my homie. I got some people coming up soon too. I've been talking to Jen. I don't know if you're familiar with Jen. He was on Too Fast, Too Furious, and he was a battle rapper and things of that nature. And then I got a couple people coming on. I'm not gonna give them all away, but I got some big things coming up. But my Instagram for my podcast is at Happy Hour with Lito Pod, and then Twitter is Lito's Happy Hour. And yeah, you know, we just doing this thing, and trying to take off, man. You know, get more viewership. And the YouTube, of course, is Happy Hour with Lito podcast. So everything is that.
And you know what? It's funny because I really like battle rapping. Battle rapping, you know, kind of separates the men from the boys. It's a totally different world and atmosphere. And I'm just really surprised that during this time of COVID, we were actually getting ready to host the battle rap event here. And COVID shut kind of everything down. But I felt like, you know what? These guys, some of these guys kind of dropped the ball. Because realistically, Zoom is a platform where, to be honest, you don't have to be in a studio. You could invite battle rappers and put this over Zoom and broadcast it. Let people decide whatever in the chat, which is nice. Because sometimes when you do battle rap, people tend to be drinking. And then they get noisy. And then you got to constantly tell people to be quiet so you can hear the dudes battling. If you do it online over Zoom, like we're doing right now, and broadcast it as a podcast, now everybody will be able to hear those battle rappers battle. And now the comments are all in the chat. You know what I'm saying? And it could be done. I'd like to see somebody step up and bring some battle rap to online.
You know, they were doing that for a while. They were doing the kind of Zoom atmosphere, but then the URL, Smack and Beasley, you know, they took their platform, and they have a platform that's on the West Coast, and you know, everybody gets COVID tested. They don't have no crowds, but they just invite the battle rappers in. They get COVID tested. I mean, it's professional. It's done through Caffeine, which is a new app that started, you know, probably like last year or the year before. And you know, so they're able to still have, you know, events and things of that nature. So, you know, I get to, and it's free. You can watch it on the app for free. They don't charge anything for that. Now the replay, of course, you know what I mean? You gotta, you know, subscribe to the URL app, which is like $8 a month or something like that. But to watch it live when it's going on, you just download Caffeine. Caffeine's, you know, completely free. And, yeah, it's dope. I still keep up on my battle rap and everything.
Did you ever battle rap?
No. Well, I wanted to. I wanted to. And, you know, I've always been like a lyrical type person. Like, I love, that's why I got involved with, you know, as far as like, you know, watching battle rap and having battle rap friends and stuff like that. So a lot of the guys that were, you know, like Big T and them, like, we cool. You know what I mean? Like, we've been Facebook or Twitter friends for years or whatever. And now that I'm doing this, you know what I mean? A lot of them like, yo, just call me. Like, I help you out. I'll come on and, you know, we can make it happen. So, yeah, bro. I mean, I'm blessed. I'm blessed that, you know.
Yeah, it's a good show. Your show's a good show, and you've had some good people on. Like I said, battle rap is one of those things that I really like. But it's a cult right now. Battle rap is a culture. I would have thought after 8 Mile that battle rap would have blown up and became mainstream, but for some reason, it didn't blow up and become mainstream for whatever reason it was. I don't understand it, because 8 Mile put the battle rap right in your face, and I would thought America would have latched onto it. It would have became, but it kind of stayed underground. It kind of stayed underground.
Yeah. And that's where,
and I think, you know, that was probably where it relishes, to be honest, right?
Yeah, that's what I was about to say. I think it's better with it being underground, because
keeps that grittiness.
Yeah. You don't never want to, you know, hip hop started from the bottom. You know what I mean? So you don't, you don't never want to. I mean, even people that are mainstream, you know what I mean? Like, a lot of the artists that I like are people that may have had a little bit of mainstream success, but mostly they're underground, you know, like Joe Budden, you know, he was, Lloyd Banks, you know what I mean? He has some mainstream success, Lloyd but Banks. He's really an underground type of guy. You know what I mean? If I could interview these dudes, like, that'd be like my dream.
To Lloyd. Lloyd does a lot of interviews with a lot of people on podcasts. So if you ever reach out to him, like I said before, like I was telling you, it's a 50-50 question in this day and age where you can just reach out to people over social media. So 50-50 question. And to be honest, don't ever be upset if somebody says no, because what's going to happen is they're going to have something that they're going to want to promote. And then they may come back around and be like, hey, I know I said no the last time, but I really got to get the word out on this product, or I got to get the word out on this show. I got to get this word out on this single that I'm promoting, and I'm coming to you this time. So, like I tell people, it's never a death sentence when somebody says no to an interview. It's a 50-50 question, and there's chances that they may come back around. So, Before we get into my show tonight, as I said, Carlito is joining me, Kevin Jefferies. I'm going to talk about my sponsors down below. Michael Douglas, Barreto, MDB Electronics. For those who know me, I'm a big gamer, and there's nothing more worse than having my controllers fail or break or drift. So, you know, what I do is I got these boxes here that I ship my controllers out to my man Michael. And what Michael does is he fixes the controllers within 24 hours. He lets you know what's going on. Fix them with 24 hours. It's like $29.99, lifetime guarantee. Sends it back within 24 hours. I'm back to playing. And if the controller breaks again or does the same thing again, I send it out to Michael. He looks at it. If it's the same problem, lifetime warranty. Don't cost a thing. He fixes it and sends it right back. So people, and I know I got to thank everybody for doing this, because Michael actually hit me up and gave me props and said thank you, because I guess there were a few people who have seen this. That have reached out to him and gotten their controllers fixed. And I got to thank you guys for helping out. Actually, someone was overseas, was trying to get a controller fixed, and was wondering if he honored the 24 hours for overseas. That obviously, you definitely can't make that type of guarantee if somebody's shipping overseas. But within the U.S., you get it within 24 hours. He sends you a tracking number, and you're all set. Also, another sponsor, Rebel ROM. That's my cousin's clothing line. You want to hit her up, check out www.rebelrom.com. She got the double R's in there, knowing that we from Massachusetts have a hard time. So this is like the hardest. This is like the hardest for me. And it's family. It's not like it's just somebody sponsored. This is family. And we got the double R's, and I'm here in Massachusetts, you know? So it's always hard. It's always probably fun. Hey, Keith's about to do that ad again. And they laugh. So. Also, Tactical Target Systems. If you guys know, I've been doing some free time at the range, going down the range. Last night, I actually went down and took Vianna Marie with me so she could do some shooting. And you know what? I'm going to hate on her right now, because she shot better than me. And I've been going to the range for a minute, and it was her first time going. And Vianna Marie is down there at the range shooting like Annie Oakley. For real, she got the rifle, the repeater rifle, looking like Chuck Connors, the rifleman, shooting. She putting bullseyes up. I'm like, damn.
That's crazy.
Was you a cowgirl in your former life? So for all y'all down there who's been wondering about Vianna Marie, yeah, she went to the range for the first time. Good stuff. And now I got to get my boys to go with me and hang up a target. Tactical Target Systems, they have all different type of targets. But the reason why it caught my eye is because I like zombies. When you go to the range to practice shooting, I want something that's going to allow me to focus and have a good time, but better myself. And I'm a big zombie fan. So I feel like if I'm a zombie guy, I'm going to put myself in these zombie situations and be thinking headshots all the time or hot shots. So I tend to focus on this, and this has really stepped up my game. It's helped me out. So good stuff there. If you guys want to reach out, ask for Don Robertson. He's actually a former LAPD police officer who created these targets with the zombies, and he patented them in 2016. So check him out. He's got a ton of stuff. So it's great stuff to bring to the range. It's a great conversation piece. So again, my artist, Vianna Marie, who I manage, I got to put this up here because she's now, you know, backing me as part of this show. And I got to give her props. So we want to make sure you check out Vianna Marie's music at all online streaming media outlets. As again, I'm giving away one of her shirts tonight. She was on DJ Bobby Steele's show last night. She's going to be on another show out of Rhode Island tomorrow. And she's performing for Joanna Hampton's fundraiser. Joanna Hampton Dance is running for city council. As you can see this picture right here, Vianna Marie is one of the performers tomorrow night. I believe it begins at 6 p.m., but if you want to tune in, Vianna's going live at around 7 p.m. Also, got to talk about behind me. If you're looking behind me, you can see J Master J, Black History Month. This is every week I'm taking the DJ for Black History Month, who I want to pay my respects to. Now, granted, we all know the story now, behind J, Master J, but that doesn't take away the accomplishments that this man made as a DJ in the hip-hop industry. It's just craziness as to what this man has done. So I just gotta give my props to him and say, you know, blessings to you up above. you were one of the best. You were one of the first DJs, black DJs, who pretty much was recognized by white kids because of the whole Aerosmith crossover that put Run DMC to the forefront of crossing over to the white fans, and it was a big deal. So God rest his soul. It's a sad story. God bless. Kailito, I'm gonna let you, because you're a battle rapper. You know about Jay, man. I'm gonna let you speak on it.
Yeah. Jam Master Jay, man. One of my favorite rappers was, you know, 50 Cent, and you know, he spoke highly of Jam Master Jay and like his interviews and stuff like that. And when he when he died and things of that nature, you know. So yeah, salute to Jam Master Jay for sure, and Run DMC. Period.
Yeah, it's good stuff, and you know, I. Man, like I said, it's just one of those things that when it happened for me, it was a straight tragedy. I didn't know what to do with myself. There's some people that when stuff happens, you know, you sit back and you say to yourself, why? You know, you say why, you know, and this is, and it was obvious too. It was obvious that when this happened, it was someone that he trusted, because he was in the studio, he was holding it down in the studio, and whoever it was, they came in and they shot him in the studio. And that's what was the horrible thing about this, is just tragic. So I myself, I'm hoping that, you know, I'm glad that they caught the people who were involved with this. You know, it's one of these things where, you know, even though they caught the person that he was, that was involved in his murder, when the story came out about, you know, the fact that he was involved in drugs and this other stuff, it was upsetting. But it goes into, maybe this is kind of a show that maybe we could get on one time and talk about, Lito, because we've seen this time and time again where sometimes people get a lot of fame, and we see it in football, we see it in basketball. People get a lot of fame, but they stay tied to the game. Let's talk. And before I get into my topic, let's kind of touch base on that. I want to talk about that with you, because, like you said, you come from the battle rap scene. Before we get into more talk, my sponsors, what are your thoughts on that? When you see guys who they're in the NFL, they're in the NBA, they've made it in the rap game, but yet they stay locked to the friggin' street lifestyle. They don't. It drives me up a wall. Like, for me, it's one of my biggest pet peeves. It pisses me off. So I'm going to let you talk on that.
I think it's just about, you know, the culture. I mean, for guys who ain't never had nothing, like, for one, like, I'll use, are you familiar with who Lenny Cook is?
I've heard that name before.
Okay. So he was a high school basketball player that was supposed to be, he was ranked higher than LeBron and Carmelo Anthony in high school. And you know what I mean? Like, he kind of had, now I've never had, like, I've never spoke with him or anything, but I watched his documentary, and from that, it's almost like, you know, kids that come from nothing, you know what I mean? And when they're given a lot, they want to come back to the hood. They want to, you know what I mean? They still got them same friends, you know what I'm saying? That may be tied to the streets, and, you know, it's all about, you know, it's all about, you know, keeping it real to a certain degree. You know, it's hard to be a black kid, you know, not given anything. And then all of a sudden you got money in your pocket all the time. You got chains around your neck. Every pair of J's that come out, you able to get them. It's hard to, you know what I mean? And he didn't end up going to the NBA. He didn't end up making it. You know what I mean? But he was supposed to be. He was cold. You know, Lenny Cook was the man. So, but there's all kind of scenarios like that, you know, with guys who, like Jeezy, for instance, you know what I mean? Like, I remember he used to say, like, you know, I got to go back home. You know, I got to go back to the streets. That's where I'm from. You know, Jeezy had $1 million before he even signed with Def Jam.
Right.
You know what I mean? He was already in a Camaro. He was already, you know what I mean? See, he was already straight. So, you know, for him, well, I mean, fame, what was it going to do? He was already the man in the streets. Like, you know what I mean? So some people just have a tough time with leaving that lifestyle. I think he's, you know, now he's more mature and he's, you know, on a different level. But, you know, back when he first got started and stuff like that, Jeezy was still 30, 40 people with him every time, everywhere he went. You know what I'm saying? you know, I don't know if it's like that with battle rap. I've never even been to a I've always wanted to go to like a URL or battle rap, you know, and just get that experience. But you know, it's right. always in New York or somewhere on the East Coast, and I live in Ohio. Now it was one in Cleveland, and I missed it. I was so mad. But yeah, I mean, I guess it's just that type of culture. It's hard to just, you know, leave the streets alone, because then your friend's gonna look at you like, oh, you know, you done sold out, kind of thing. So you know,
right?
It's a tough thing. You know what I mean? You got to be a strong-willed person for real to deal with that.
Yeah, it's tough, and we've seen it time and time again. I actually was telling Vianna Marie the story of Rake Ruth. And we were talking about that as I scroll through the beanies and things that people have bought for us. What has bothered me is like Ray Cruz's story. He he had made it, and he was tied to the streets, and you know, he got all that money real quick, and you know, he got into a relationship with a stripper, and then it went, you know, it just went downhill from there. It was just a sad story. He committed murder. He murdered the stripper girlfriend that he had, and it's just a sad story all around. I just don't know how we can change that. Is it something we can educate? I just don't know. I just wish that we could just do something about it, because time and time again, it just sucks. What's up, Van Bates in the chat? I see you in there. Vianna Marie is in the chat. She gave a shout out to Erik Young. Yeah, it's a tough one. Moving on into the news booth, Brockton Police Force welcomes new K-9 Officer Woody to the ranks. If you guys don't remember, last month the Brockton Police had a K-9 officer who was dropped off at a shelter while his owner, you know, his partner, went to training in Florida. When he came back, the dog got sick and he passed away. So this is a new K-9 to another officer. Woody is only 9 months old, and he's the first Labrador to be placed on the Brockton Police unit, which is a good thing. Also in the news booth, Texas has become a major wintry nightmare. For those who don't know, Texas is suffering a winter storm, ice storm down there. Lines have been down for days. There's like a million people without power. Someone shared a picture or a video on TikTok of their fish tank, because they have no heat. Their fish tank froze with the fish in it. It is a bad situation down there.
That's
crazy. Texas ain't used to that cold like we are up here in New England. We, you know, sometimes we take stuff for granted up here. We have heat all the time. Our electricity is pretty much fixed. But they're at a complete standstill. It's pretty scary down there. So my prayers and blessings and stuff, our thoughts are going out to these people in Texas right now. You want to add anything to that, man?
Yeah, I got some people in Texas right now.
And, oh, okay. All right.
Yeah. So one of my homeboys, he told me he has power, but he don't have any water. Him and his kids. You know what I mean? So and then my other, and he's in San Antonio. My other guy, he's in Houston, I believe. Yeah, and somebody said Houston had power. It was a couple hours ago, so it may be some power in Houston. But man, I mean, I'm like I said, I'm used to the cold in Ohio. We're right by Michigan. You know what I mean? So
right.
It's always cold. You know, it's nothing new to me. But you know, I guess if I lived in Texas and never been, you know, up north or anything like that, you know, I wouldn't really know how to deal with it. I mean, my one friend, he said, you know, I'm from Ohio, so I know how to drive in snow, you know, rain. He said people in Texas don't even know how to drive in the rain. So he can imagine how it's going on right now. And he said the governor kind of failed him.
He said, I heard that. Yeah. Go ahead. Yeah, put it out there.
Yeah, he said the governor kind of failed them, because, you know, a lot of them should, you know, why is power still down now? Why is the power not up? You know what I mean? Like, why they don't have resources for water and stuff like that? He said his pipe busted in his at his place. So, you know, they don't have like people coming out. I mean, it's a crazy thing. You know what I mean? Like, the governor has really failed Texas for real.
Yeah, I heard that, and it's a tough situation. Like I said, it's crazy. I would not want to be in that situation where, you know, you don't have any heat, you don't have any water. and the situation gets bad really fast. You know, and you talk about the older people who are without power there. It just gets to be a really bad situation. So I'm just hoping that things do pan out. I'm hoping things do get better there in Texas. My whole thing is just it's a tough situation. So
Texas for sure.
Moving on in the legal booth, Trump's second acquittal was at the Senate level. Everybody was kind of surprised. I was surprised. And I had a lot of people in my inbox saying, Keith, why were you surprised? You were, you know, early on, you were saying that this was all going to happen. This was all going to be a way to protect democracy because nobody will ever put a president in jail. And I had thought maybe things had changed. I had thought maybe he was going to end up answering for what he did. Now, the Senate has allowed him to be acquitted for a second time, but the civil suits are coming for him and Rudy from all these different states as far as the insurrection goes, as far as the lies about the election results and things of that sort. So it may not be over for President Trump. These civil suits, we've seen this before. Again, we've seen people dodge murder charges like O.J. Simpson. If it don't fit, you must acquit. OJ was acquitted, but OJ ended up paying in a civil suit at the end of the day. And then he did some stupid stuff in Denver, and he ended up in jail anyway. Until this day, I say he was set up, he was played, because whoever knew that law, that one law in Denver that was going to put him in jail that's not in any other state, I said they knew what they was doing, that he was set up. And I'm pretty sure the Furman, the family of Ron Furman, did that one. That's my opinion. I'm not saying that I know. That's just my opinion. I don't know if you want to speak on that real quick.
Yeah, I'll speak on, I mean, okay. Listen, when it comes to Donald Trump, man, I've never seen a president with a cult following like him. Like, you know what I'm saying? It's crazy. Like, I didn't think he would get, convicted, because, I mean, like, a lot of people scared to pull the trigger on that stuff. You know what I mean? Like, they, you know, they may be afraid of what might happen. You know, all the people that voted for him. You know what I mean? Like, you seen,
right.
He had people come to the Capitol. You know what I'm saying? Like, so people might have wanted to, you know, wanted to vote, you know, against him, but they was like, shh, nah, he not coming after me. So I don't know. It's kind of weird. You know what I mean? Like, the way the world has been, you know, or the United States and things of that nature, you know, with how this whole polls and presidential, all of this stuff is crazy to me. I'm not really a
politics guy.
Yeah, like I don't really like politics, because it's all, you know, it's basically just about voting in, you know, the lesser of two evils.
Right. And degree. That's kind of how this one was, to be honest. Yeah. This one was definitely like that this time. You know, yeah. I'm not a big fan of Joe Biden, but there were some things that Trump had did that I was like, yeah, I just can't do it. And as you know, and we had to do what we had to do, and hopefully it works out for the better. You know, we'll see. We'll all see at the end of the day. So
my main thing with Trump was, you know, he didn't really say much about the police killing black people thing. Mm-hmm. That was my problem. Like, you know what I mean? Like, he wasn't someone that was real vocal about that. And then, like, I seen at one of his rallies, he said something like, you know, look at my African American. You feel me? Like, that's, you know what I'm saying? Like, I have a problem with, and I don't understand how people wouldn't have a, you know, you talk to people and they really don't, if you mention that, they don't, you know, it's always, oh, he didn't mean it that way, or no, a slave master says, you're mine. You know what I mean? Like, or that slave mentality, you know, look at my African American. Isn't he great? Look at him. He's dancing. You know what I'm saying? Like, that didn't sit right with me, the way he handled the police, you know, killing black people. That's a whole nother, we can talk about that on a whole nother show. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I grew up studying the Black Panthers and stuff like that. So my mindset has always been real militant when it comes to, you know, things of that nature. So we can dive in on that, you know, at another time.
Yeah, definitely. Talk about this for an hour. Exactly. Pierre Marie said, some of y'all ain't never been pouring. It shows these people will be okay. She just said somebody resigned. Somebody we were talking about resigned. Moving on in the entertainment booth, I actually had something going wrong down below here. My topics weren't showing up. But Rush Limbaugh, talk radio's conservative leader, he passed away at 70. As you know, he was announced that he had cancer, lung cancer, and it took him pretty fast. It took Screech. Cancer just sucks. I don't care if you're black, white, yellow, brown, pink, whatever. Cancer sucks. It is a horrible way to pass away. I've lost family members to cancer.
Me too.
The fact that cancer has not, they haven't made any type of dent in cancer, it's just craziness beyond. Yeah, it's just crazy. And again, that's a whole show. That's another hour topic. If you really wanted to get into the money around what they make in medicine from cancer and stuff, it's just horrible. So 70 years old, Rush Limbaugh, he was a big Trump guy towards the end. He was one of these conspiracy guys, and, you know, he was loyal to Trump right to the end. But again, whether you agreed or disagreed with him, you still, again, like J Master J, you can't take away what Rush brought to talk radio. He's one of these guys that gave everybody a platform. A lot of these people who are doing podcasting right now are fans of Rush, and they're in podcasting because they thought they could be the next Rush. So, with, like I said, if you can agree or disagree with him, you can't take away the achievements and what he did in radio as a host. Moving on into the entertainment booth, Claudia Conway showed up on American Idol. And I wasn't happy with this because I was a big fan of American Idol. And one of the reasons why I stopped watching American Idol is due to the fact that they started bringing in people, I would say, I would call them, in my opinion, plants for ratings. For those who don't know who Claudia Conway is, she is the daughter of George Conway and Kellyanne Conway. George Conway is the founder of the Lincoln Project. He can't stand Trump. Yet his wife, Kellyanne Conway, worked for Donald Trump. And there was just this whole thing about 2 weeks ago where her and her daughter were beefing because her daughter is this big influencer on TikTok with thousands and thousands of followers. And she shared a topless photo of her daughter on her Twitter feed that she caught hell for. I till this day, I don't know why a mother would share a topless picture of her daughter on her Twitter page. And then she turned around and blamed the boyfriend and said, the boyfriend, I don't care. It's just a weird, strange relationship. Claudia Conway was on American Idol. She was there with her dad. She didn't travel with her mother. Her mother was off camera. They put her up on the screen so she could talk to her. So I thought that was kind of funny. But she did go on. She moves on. She's going off to the next round. Some people are saying that they're using her to bring in ratings. I feel maybe that's so. We'll see. She's got a voice, so I don't know if you want to chime in on that one. Your thoughts on Claudia Conway?
That's just an interesting. I mean, one person can't stand Trump, the other one works for him, and then
it's a crazy dynamic. I would not want to be that husband and wife duo.
Like, not at all. I mean, how does that work?
Yeah, it's crazy, and it's almost like a friggin' another reality show within itself. Moving on, for all you guys know, I'm a Weeknd fan. I like the Weeknd's music, and when they announced that the Weeknd was going to be hosting the Super Bowl halftime show, Pepsi put him out there. I said this. I predicted this. I said, first of all, on Monday morning after the Super Bowl, everybody is going to be saying it's the worst Super Bowl performance ever, halftime performance ever. I said that. I predicted it, and it happened. I also said that you are going to be explaining to people what the hell did he mean and what was he doing, because he does these crazy things that people don't understand that's part of his show. Again, I predicted it. It was true. And he paid $7 million out of his own pocket to be the halftime special performer. That $7 million has paid off, because despite the fact that everybody hated his performance, he became a meme for a lot of things. So he was trending right away the next day. And now it's turned into, he's going to have a documentary on Showtime about this whole Super Bowl and what led up to it and what happened behind the scenes. So that $7 million he spent and all these people who were talking about how bad and how horrible and how it was the worst, look, the Weeknd is about to get paid. And then what did he do last week? He announced tickets for his concert in 2022, and they sold.
2022?
Yeah, next year. Put his tickets on sale for next year, and they sold. They're sold.
The Weeknd is, I like some of the Weeknd's music. He's kind of a weird guy. Weird dude.
He is. Oh yeah, he is. He's weird.
He's definitely a weird dude, but I like some of his music for sure. I mean, he's from Canada. Mm-hmm. So, you know, most of them, they make good music anyway. So, I mean, I can put on his music and catch a vibe, a vibe for real. But the performance at the Super Bowl was kind of, I didn't know what was happening. I didn't understand. At first, I was like, okay, well, maybe he's trying to put a little spin on, like, with the mask and everything on this whole COVID thing.
Yeah,
but maybe not. I don't know. You know what I'm saying? So what he's going to do, I mean, that was smart of them to do a documentary, because now you're going to be able to see why he did what he did. Mm-hmm. And, you know, people going to watch it for sure. You know what I mean?
Oh, yeah.
And
yeah,
that $7 million that he spent, he probably made. I mean, how much he make that night?
That's what I'm saying. He made his money back. He made his and money some. Back in marketing, and yeah, he made his money back in being trending. And like I said, now he's got this Showtime special. So you can't hate, appreciate people.
Yeah.
Because I've said this before, we're in the era of where bad press is the best thing for you sometimes, you know, these days. So it's stuff. Another big story, and I got to put this out there because we usually don't put stories out here like this, but about a month ago, about 3 weeks ago, there were some FBI officers who went to issue a warrant, and they were caught off guard, and both those FBI agents were slain at the scene. Both were killed. Kodak Black has now stepped up and offered to cover the college tuition of the children of those slain FBI agents who were shot in that massacre about 3 weeks ago. And you know what? This is, again, this is one of those stories that should go out there because, you know, we don't, if a rapper does something wrong, everybody's quick to share and like, yep, and spread the story. And I hate to say this, but Black people too, we ourselves are big time guilty of doing that. You know, we're, yep, quick to share all this crazy stuff that we see, but when you see a story like Kodak Black doing this, we don't share it. We don't see, I put it up and I got like 8 likes. But if I put a booty girl up on TikTok and put that on my page, I got 150 likes and 87,000 comments.
You preaching to the choir. It's, you know, it's crazy. That's dope that Kodak did that. Like for sure, you know what I mean? People, but you know, people don't like to, I put up a, if you put up a post about becoming an entrepreneur, having your own business, you might get 10 likes, but if you put up that you got a new job, you get 100 likes, you know what I'm saying? It's like, it's almost like we are, you know, people don't know how to celebrate you when you don't want to work for no one but yourself, you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And that's in a lot in the Black community too. I mean, you know, I mean, we did it before, like, you know, as far as, you know, my fiance, you know what I mean? She started her own business and not too many people said anything, but I seen somebody say something about, oh man, I just got a new job, you know, working at, you know, Walmart. You got like 100, you know what I'm saying? 100 likes and stuff like that. And I'm not trying to talk about the person that's working at Walmart, but I'm just saying, like, what is it with people that when you see somebody trying to be their own boss, you're like, oh man, I can't like that. But you see somebody that wants to work in the corporate world and you're okay with that. You're cool with that. It's like, come on, man. We got like a backwards mentality.
Vianna Marie's probably in there. I know she's about to put preach because I know she says that type of stuff all the time.
It's crazy.
It's crazy. So moving on in the entertainment booth, Netflix has announced season 3 of The Kingdom. This was the Asian zombie horror show. Look, it took me by storm. It to be honest, by the time I got done watching season 2 of The Kingdom,
I'm hyped.
It was almost right up there with Walking Dead. The Kingdom is a zombie apocalypse show, but it takes place during the Shogun era, where they have muskets, and the majority of everybody has just swords. So take yourself out of The Walking Dead and put yourself back in the Shogun era with just swords and muskets, which you got to sit here and while the zombies...
We are, in my household, like, The Walking Dead is everything. I've watched The Walking Dead from season one up until this past, like this, I've watched every episode. Mm-hmm. I'm not like, I would survive just because all I need is a sword. Just give me Michonne's sword, I'm good. I don't need a gun. I don't need a gun. That sword, you know what I mean? I don't need a gun for that at all. We, you know what I'm saying? Stab him right in the head. That's it.
So you are a sword blunt object type of guy. Who made you? Yeah. Okay, real quick, before we move on, what death made you cry? Because everybody got that one that choked them up. Like, oh.
Probably Glenn, man, the way he went out. I didn't like that, man. I wanted to like go into TV. Like, don't let Glenn go out like that. That was messed up. You know what I'm saying? Glenn was one of my favorite characters. Like, I mean, Glenn was the man, especially in season one, all the risk he took. I mean, Glenn was the man, and the way that they had him go out, I met Shane. I actually have a picture with him. Ooh, I met Shane.
Nice.
Yeah, he's a cool dude. You know, he plays the Punisher too.
That's right. He's a good actor.
He's a man. Yeah, yeah. Dude, Shane, I didn't like Shane. I didn't like how Shane went out either. I wanted him to last. Like if he would have been around, like when, like these last few seasons, if he would have still been around, ain't nobody messing with them. Shane was the man that he'll fight anybody, shoot anybody. You're not gonna be able to tell me like, yeah, he didn't play. So
yeah, and it's funny you talk about Glenn because people forget that Glenn was the second character introduced when Rick Grimes got into Atlanta and found the tank and the zombies was around the tank. And the first lines he uttered was "Hey asshole," you know, and out of that walkie-talkie, and Rick picks it up, and it's Glenn. That was Glenn, the pizza delivery guy. So you know, I give props to Glenn. His character came along. You know, he was this wimpy character. Until they put him in that room with that zombie, the walker, by himself. And then the Glenn character changed after that. And he became a really good, strong character. I really liked. So for me, it was the same thing. When Glenn got killed by Negan, man. I felt the man tear came up.
Yeah, facts.
I was so upset.
I was so upset, bro. Like, I was like, oh, man, Glenn.
Yeah.
Like, you know what I'm saying? It was just one of those things where we was just watching the TV, like.
Deanna Marie said Glenn. She said Glenn and Carl.
Carl
was a tough one. Yeah, when you knew he got bit, you were like, oh.
Yeah, when Carl died, that was, you know, it was crazy too. But yeah, Glenn for sure. The way Negan bashed his head in, man, that was just like, I was like, oh, man.
Yeah.
Nobody gonna get up and do nothing. I would have got up. If I would have, me and Glenn would have went out, but we wouldn't have went out like that.
So man, so if you guys haven't seen it, The Kingdom season 3 has been announced. Look, guys, this is just watch it. That's all. Everybody that I've told to watch the show comes back in my inbox and like, yo. I'm like, don't even say nothing. Just wait till season 3. I'm the same way. So moving on in the entertainment booth. Also, I'm about to share the new Godzilla trailer that came out this week. The third new trailer for Godzilla. I'm about to share that. I'm just letting y'all know it's coming up. But tomorrow, 9 p.m., the Mortal Kombat trailer premieres on WB, on YouTube, everywhere.
Yo.
HBOMAX. Look. R-rated. The first Mortal Kombat movie, legendary. It was off the chain. In my eyes, it's the best video game movie ever made, even above Resident Evil. That first Mortal Kombat, even though it was PG-13, off the chain. Mortal Kombat Annihilation, the TV show, that was off the chain too. So. Mm-hmm. Now they're about to bring an updated version with everybody in it with an R rating. Mm. We've been patiently waiting for an R rating.
I can't wait. HBO Max too. Like, it's gonna be, you know, in the, I can't wait. This trailer, that's gonna be so epic.
Yeah, the trailer premieres tomorrow, so I will definitely have the trailer here next week for those who miss it. But I can't wait. Mortal Kombat. Look, I just Liu Kang, Shang Tsung, Melina is in this one. They're all in this, and I'm just hoping that they do it right.
Yeah, the R rating,
do it right. Yeah, we can't wait. So it's good. Also, as I just said, Kong versus Godzilla, King Kong versus Godzilla, Kong. Whatever, I don't care what you want to call it. It's Godzilla versus Kong. And I'm just going to show you this clip right here. This is Destroyer. Now, it's rumored that if you hang around at the end of this film for the post-credit scene, Destroyer is the next creature to be featured in the Monsterverse. Now, this is a big deal with this rumor. Why? Because supposedly, right now, the Monsterverse, WB, Warner Brothers, and Legendary, the contract is up with Toho Pictures. In other words, the rights to these monsters go back to Toho Films, Toho Pictures, which means we wouldn't get any more Godzilla Kong movies. By hearing that Destroyer is being teased at the end of the post-credit scene of this Godzilla vs. Kong movie lets me believe that they've extended this agreement. And I'm hoping so. So for those who didn't see it, Godzilla vs. Kong trailer just was released. The third trailer. And what I'm going to do here is I'm going to get this trailer on for you guys so you can check this out. Here is the third trailer for Godzilla vs. Kong with brand new footage. I can't wait. I'm counting down the days. Here it goes on the booth.
We need Kong. The world needs him. She's the only one he'll communicate with.
It's Godzilla.
Kong in theaters and streaming exclusively on HBO Max March 31st, rated PG-13.
All right, back here in the booth, broadcasting live from the City of Champions, Godzilla versus Kong. As you guys saw, there was new footage there. The scene of King Kong. Well, he's not King Kong yet. He's just Kong. The scene of Kong hitting Godzilla with an aircraft carrier. Come on now.
Facts. That's crazy. I can't wait. I can't wait for that.
Come on, son. Godzilla getting hit with an aircraft. Look, I love my stuff, man. I can't wait for this. I'm just ecstatic. So we are at 7:53, shows flying along here. We're going to head into the sports booth. Well, actually, we're going to close out the entertainment booth first. I got to close out the entertainment booth with this story. Justin Timberlake has come out, and he has issued an apology to Britney Spears and Janet Jackson in regards to his treatment of them. For those who don't remember, Justin and Britney Spears were, you know, hot throb, teenage love, whatever. And she cheated on him, and he really, you know, they really dragged her through the mud and all this stuff. And he never supported her or stayed by her. So people were pissed at that. So now they've got this whole new Netflix special about Britney Spears. And, you know, they really took a hammering to Justin Timberlake in this Netflix documentary about Britney Spears. To the point where he's come out now. Yeah, he just come out and issued an apology.
And he shouldn't. I mean, just to me, like, I mean, you know, Justin's a good dude. Everybody knows that he stayed out of trouble for the most part. You know, the thing that happened with Janet Jackson was an accident. You know what I'm saying? I mean, what is he? just because, you know, he made the, you know, the Cry Me a River song. Everyone loves that. He killed. He was talking about Britney and that. I mean, listen, you know, everybody wants to come and try to slay Justin now. You know what I mean? I just can't agree with it. I mean, Justin's always going to, you know, that's the homie. I like Justin, so whatever.
Actually, Viana Marie, I got to go back to the Walking Dead. She said Shane needed to go, period. Man lost his whole mind having to watch a whole nother man raise his child. No good and goddamn well that baby was his and not Rick's.
Hey, that's a fact. But, I mean, Shane, you know, he was wrong, you know, for the way, you know, he tried to take Rick's wife. But, you know, he was a protector, though. Shane was loyal. I mean, listen.
Well, he wasn't loyal to Rick.
Yeah, he wasn't loyal to Rick, but, you know.
He wasn't loyal to Rick.
So. Yeah, that's true. He wasn't loyal to Rick, but he was, you know, he would take care of business. If something, you know, if they had to fight next to each other, they would.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So, because we've got this apology coming out for Justin Timberlake, we have a segment here on the booth called the Apology Podium. So, usually what happens is when a big-time celebrity comes out and has to give an apology, the booth would like to recognize that apology and give them their moment to shine. Now, Justin Timberlake released the statement. He released his apology over Instagram. We really didn't have to face anybody. But what we did is we took our segment and we let Viana Marie, artist Viana Marie, tell and read Justin Timberlake's statement to everybody that he released over Instagram. He got a little heart emoji and I love you from his wife, Jessica Biel. Oh, we're all happy about that. But here's right now, here's our little segment, the Apology Podium featuring Justin Timberlake. Here we go.
I've seen the messages, tags, comments, and concerns, and I want to respond. I am deeply sorry for the times in my life where my actions contributed to the problem, where I spoke out of turn or did not speak up for what was right. I understand that I fell short in these moments and in many others and benefited from a system that condones misogyny and racism. I specifically want to apologize to Britney Spears and Janet Jackson, both individually, because I care for and respect these women and I know I failed. I also feel compelled to respond in part because everyone involved deserves better, and most importantly, because this is a larger conversation that I wholeheartedly want to be part of and grow from. Boy, bye.
I respect that.
Big ups to Viana Marie for putting the voiceover on that and the boy bye at the end.
I respect it.
Good stuff, man. And moving on, again, as we get ready to close out the show, we got a couple of quick topics to talk about. We have Lauren Grohl. She is the Trophy Karen. Trophy Karen is upset because she wants Tom Brady to give her an apology because he tossed the Super Bowl Lombardi trophy from boat to boat. She's upset. And I'm going to let you speak on it before I get into this video. Your thoughts on this woman, Lorraine, who has now been dubbed Trophy Karen.
I read up on it. She talking about she couldn't sleep after seeing that. Come on. Like, Tom Brady, he can do whatever he want to do, number one. And number two, he would have just replaced it if it went in the water and they couldn't get it back. he could buy plenty of those. So I just think she was just, you know, I mean, if that causes you not to sleep, you might want to, you know, see a counselor or something.
Right. So here's what we got to do. Fox 4 covered the story. They actually interviewed Lorraine. And what I did here is the booth put together something special for everybody. This is the booth spin on the interview with Lorraine at Fox 4 out of Tampa. Vianna Marie said, Justin Timberlake's apology is tired and late. He has great PR people. Awesome. I love it. So here we are. This is Lorraine Groh on Brady's trophy toss. Here we go.
I have a big history of this trophy being made by my father, and it's such an honor. And I know all the craftsmen that made it when my dad was there also at Tiffany's, and it takes a lot of work, a lot of hard work, a lot of hours go into it. It just really upset me that this trophy was disgraced and disrespected by being thrown as if it was a real football.
You heard that right. Lorraine Groh's father, Greg Groh, was the master silversmith at Tiffany & Company that crafted the world-famous Vince Lombardi trophy back in 1967 until his retirement in 1994. Groh tells us she's upset because she knows all the hard work that goes into making this coveted trophy awed by the world.
I didn't sleep for the past two nights because of this. I was that upset because I know the passion that goes into this trophy and how my dad and all his fellow silversmiths are so proud to make this. I've seen this trophy being made at the factory in Tiffany's. My father did the seams. He had to chisel the seams by hand. There is a newspaper article that shows him working on that trophy, chiseling it. And the ball is hand-formed as the base is as well.
Groh says she's not a football fan and doesn't pay much attention to the game, but she watches it till the end for one specific reason.
I only watch the game to watch the trophy come out, and I like to see all the owners and the football players just hold it up with such pride and just hold it up and show everybody, and it's just, I get goosebumps. Like right now I'm getting goosebumps from it because I'm very proud.
And tonight Groh has one message for the seven-time Super Bowl champion.
This has nothing to do with your athletic ability whatsoever. It has everything to do with disrespecting a highly coveted trophy that a lot of work goes into by the silversmiths and all the other team players. I personally would like an apology, not just to me and my family and the other silversmiths, but to the fans, to all the fans out there, all the football fans, the other team players.
Lighten up, Francis.
She definitely needs to lighten up. For sure.
She was doing just too much. Man, before we get out of here, I got a Biden bombshell real quick. Which you guys know, we transitioned from Trump troubles to Biden bombshells. So we call things out when we feel it's not right or when things are good. Joe Biden came out this week. He had a town hall, and the biggest thing that came out of his online town hall is that he's rethinking the cancellation of student debt. They were looking at originally trying to eliminate about 10 grand to 50 grand of student debt. He's now pulled that off the table. He said that at this time he's not discussing it. There's more important matters. It's going to be tabled for now, but at this time, anybody who is leveled with student debt, it's going to remain until this time. To be honest, my just quick thoughts on student debt, it is a horrible thing. The thing is that we can erase that debt. The problem is that, you know, you have to go after these companies that put these high percentage rates out there to begin with and drew these kids in, to be honest. And it's going to, this is just going to continue to keep happening. So what we need to do is get that under control and hold these people, these banks and stuff, accountable. You know, the first thing you hear when freshmen arrive on college, and here's the thing, problem people, a lot of these young kids, they get to college, they know nothing about managing their finances, to be honest. They've been under the roof of mom and dad. When you register as a freshman in college, what's the first thing you see on college campuses? Credit card companies. Fill this out. fill that out. So not only are you racking up student debt out the gate because you're going to college, you're racking up financial debt because they're giving you credit cards right out the gate. Oh, this will help you buy books that the tuition won't cover. So when your tuition doesn't cover like 20% of whatever books you need, you're going to put that 20% right on that credit card.
Yep,
at 23% interest, you know? So yep, they're setting you up for failure and debt right away. So my feeling is, I know a lot of people are upset at Joe Biden at not erasing this debt, but it's not just about erasing the debt, people. We've got to hold the creditors accountable. They knew what they was doing. To be honest, you got to hold them accountable the same way that we held banks accountable who allow people to buy houses that they knew, that the banks knew that people weren't going to afford when the rates came back. A lot of banks, Bank of America had to answer for it. There were a ton of banks across the country, but Bank of America took a humongous hit for giving people loans on houses that they knew once the rates climbed back up, they weren't going to be able to afford it. You know, you buy a house for $100,000, your mortgage is whatever it is, but the bank doesn't tell you that, yeah, but when the property value goes up, your mortgage is going to go up. And then that's what happens. The property value goes up, your tax rate goes up, your mortgage goes up. Then all of a sudden, guess what? That house you bought 10 years ago, you can't afford because it's out of your reach. And the banks need to be held accountable in the same way with the colleges. Anything you want to add on that before we get out of here?
Man, I'm a student myself. So I'm in school right now. So if he were to, hearing that he was going to get rid of the debt, that would have been awesome. You know what I'm saying? At least, however much he was going to get rid of, 10,000, 20,000, whatever, it would have helped a lot of people. I understand that he has a lot on his table right now as far as trying to get all these vaccines and, you know, other things. But that's why you got to appoint somebody in a position where they can take care of that too. It's important.
Yeah, and it's coming. I believe that's what's coming. I think he wants to get everybody, like right now he's flying out this weekend to handle some overseas. He's got to rebuild relationships back overseas that was strained. So he's dealing with that right now. So we'll see what happens. So as we get ready to get out of here, it was a great show. Before I let Lito say his goodbyes, I'm just going to move on here. As you guys see down below, the Sinister One beanies are in the house. And if you see my man Daryl Smith, I got to give him a big shout out for taking on a Sinister One production beanie. Last night, we was hanging out with DJ Bobby Steels. If you guys know who DJ Bobby Steels is, hold it down. Vianna Marie was on his show last night. There he is with his Sinister One production beanie. Jamie Canfield, prayers going up to you, man. Jamie Canfield, rocking the beanie, but I just found out that Jamie Canfield is in the COVID unit. He's not doing good at Brockton Hospital. So my prayers and blessings are going out to you for, I hope you get better, brother, man. I hope things get better for you. Do not succumb to this, man, because this would be horrible. Corey the Barber, I got to give my barber a shout. Wearing my brand. UFC fighter Peter Barrett, what's going on? Hanging out with me. There he is with his Sinister One Productions hat. My cousin's son, Rebel Rom Clothing. Big shout out to you. My stepson, Ryan Beeson, holding it down. What's going on, Patrick Goldstone? I see you in the chat. My artist, Vianna Marie, looking real good in there, taking these pictures with my hat on. Travis Partington of Oscar Mike Radio Podcast, holding it down. I support his brand. He's supporting my brand. That's how it works. Matt Cameron of Maddie C Sports for You and Me, holding down the Sinister One production beanie. I had a Matt Cameron, Maddie C Sports for You and Me shirt last week. And again, for you guys out here who are podcasting, that's what it's all about. Get your brand. Start getting your merchandise out there. So you are now, your podcast is now a business and not just a hobby. So I want you guys to check out Oscar Mike Radio, Maddie C Sports for You and Me. And up here on the left, you guys see him. Happy Hour with Lito, Carlito, man, Kevin Jefferies. Let them know how they can watch you and find you, man. Because your show is hot, man.
Yeah, for sure. So, you can download the Anchor app. It's free. You can look me up on there. It's everything's the same. Happy Hour with Lito on Spotify, Apple Podcasts. Like I said, my Twitter is Lito's Happy Hour. My Instagram is Happy Hour with Lito Pod, just P-O-D. And YouTube is Happy Hour with Lito. Facebook, Happy Hour with Lito. Same thing, you know what I'm saying? Everything is exactly what it is, my name. So, yeah.
Good stuff. Great to have you on. I'm going to actually have you on again. We got a lot of stuff that I think if we have a, if I have a slow week or something, there's some topics that we may want to bring out and bring on. I think I'm going to bring you back on. Okay. Again, people, if you want to reach out to him, did you give an email if people want to reach out to you for getting guest spots on your show? Or
yeah, you can you can email me at KVN Jefferies, which is spelled J-E-F as in Frank, F as in Frank, E-R-I-E-S at gmail.com.
So reach out to him. I'm actually going to try to see about getting my my artists on your show, because you have a good network of battle rappers and music people, comedians and stuff. So Vianna Marie would be a definitely good look to get on your show.
I'll, comedians, I'll actors, fighters.
Yeah.
You know, I'm trying to get more fighters on too, like boxers, MMA. I love talking about MMA because MMA is like, that's, you know, in my, you know, I think if I died and came back, I'd probably be an MMA fighter.
I'm gonna thank everybody in the chat holding it down. That's Carlito, Kevin Jefferies, man, hanging out with us. Hey, all I gotta say is make sure to tune in tomorrow night. Vianna Marie performing live for Joanna Hampton Dance, who's running for Worcester City Council. She will be performing live at 7 o'clock. So you want to jump into that live stream and check it out. And again, thank you everybody for tuning into the show. And SpongeBob, do me a favor, take me home. Peace.
Well, see you next Tuesday.
Thank you for listening to The Booth on Hoobazoo and HatcherRadio.com. Please follow the Facebook page and subscribe to the podcast at Apple Podcast, iHeartRadio, and Spotify. The Booth is a Sinister One production hosted by Sinister One.
I've got to start hanging out with friends that are a little more intelligent and understand politics and stuff. It's just that I'm up on this level up here, and all my friends are down here. Me, nah. You guys, nah. Maybe a little more down in here. Screw you guys, I'm going home.
I smoke, I drink, I do my thing. These bitches hating, so you know I got to make it plain. Don't do cocaine with your chick, my main. We stick together, true forever, yeah, you know we bang. I miss those days, which was easy. If only I make it, bitch, don't repeat. Now that I done upgraded, I've been upstate, but y'all think I'm playing. And I gotta hit now for these weak ass hoes who think I ain't slaying. Try me, and I'll probably end up laughing, cause I never back down. I'm that chick with a clean ass whip, I don't need that shit, cause I got my own now. I get hurt, I get tired of fussing, fighting, guess I gotta crack down. Don't mess with me, cause on everything, I'ma have to bring the whole city out.
W-H-O-O-B-A-Z-O-O, that's Hoobazoo.com.
Enter website, enter website, enter website, enter website.